Hi, everybody. Welcome to Paul Lisnick Behind the Curtain, my opportunity to step away from the worlds of politics and law that you watch me cover every day on television to get into a real passion of mine, of course, which is theater and the arts. And today we talk to somebody who may be familiar to you just from looking at him and even from his projects that you should be watching if you've missed them. But it's not why we're talking to him. It's because he's coming to Chicago. We'll get into all of that. Say hi to Jeff Hiller, who's here to join me today. Jeff, so good to see you again.
Thank you for having me. It's great to be here.
So when last we talked, it was on radio. We were doing Afternoon Drive. I'm sort of curious, am I better looking than you thought I would be? And question two, why are you thinking of how good looking I was going to be?
Oh, this feels like a trap. You are so much, you know what? You are just as beautiful as I thought you would be.
Oh, thank you.
It is so weird, though, to see someone's face from the radio that you know.
Yeah, well, except not you, because I've seen your face and we all see your face. So people should know you from a variety of things. Somebody Somewhere is where I'm not sure it's where I first came in contact with you, but it's certainly when I fell in love with your work and what you do. The show on HBO, where you play Joel with your partner in crime, Bridget Everett, who's from this area. I'm pretty sure Bridget's from here, Chicago area.
She's from Kansas, but we actually shoot the show in the Chicago area.
Okay, that's the Chicago tie. I knew it was Chicago. And Kansas, Chicago, you know, we're all Midwest. And to be honest, the way you come across in the show, you come across very Midwest, but you come from the liberal state of Texas.
Yes, the liberal state of Texas. It's a great place to visit, but I wouldn't want to grow up gay there. Yes, I come from San Antonio, Texas, but you know.
Actually, that's a good part of Texas.
Yeah, it's not bad, actually. It's really not bad.
If you couldn't live there, live in Austin.
Yes, well, that's where my sister lives now, and I was just there for Christmas, and it is the better option.
And that's probably because we were talking at Christmas time on the radio. That's probably where you were when we were doing that.
Yes, I was. I was in my sister's.
So Somebody Somewhere is where people, if they have not seen the HBO show, go stream the first two seasons. Third season coming. We'll talk about that and lots to talk about that show. But in addition, the other place that I kind of surprisingly saw you, so I just want to bring it up because I know American Horror Story has a huge fan base and a huge audience. And there I am watching this season. The theme was sort of gay themed with, you know, the characters and whatever. And then they start getting murdered. And who murders them? You. What is that all about? What a character shit.
I know, right? It is. So, you know, Ryan Murphy offered me a job. What am I going to do? Say no?
Well, how did he? What did he find? Did he find you from? I'm not sure what came first. Did he find you from the HBO show? Where did he find you?
Well, I had done an episode of The Watcher, which is another show that he did. And he happened to be editing that episode while also going home at night and watching Somebody Somewhere. And he saw me play these, you know, a therapist in The Watcher and a, you know, nice friend in Somebody Somewhere. And he said, oh, hey, let's try this. Let's see if this guy can kill people. And,
and
2 weeks later, I was carving up a kid, you know?
Yeah. And as I said, I brought this story up on radio, but it's not anything you didn't try to do before when you start on Broadway and Bloody Bloody Andrew Jackson.
That's true. I did accidentally assault someone. We had a stage fight, like a comedic fight, and I had this prop knife, and I was meant to just freeze with the knife aimed at someone, and I just let the knife go off into the audience. And it thankfully did not land on anyone's head. It landed in the aisle, but wow, it was stressful.
Did that person, you know, I collect theater props and stuff. I have tons of stuff. So did that person, like if it were me, you would not have gotten the knife.
I don't know. That's a good question for stage manager, and I should have asked them.
Yeah. So you're coming to Chicago to appear at the Den on February 4th. You're doing a stand-up comedy act, so people need to know that about you as well. And is there a name to this show? I know you've been touring with a show. What show are we getting here?
The show is called Middle-Aged Ingenue.
Oh, that is what you've been touring with. Yeah.
Yes, exactly. And it's a story about finding, you know, success in midlife, later midlife.
And it's interesting, your showtime starts, I'm saying these things so people know, but again, the Den Theater, which is on Milwaukee, but you know what time you start?
7:15.
Yeah, I thought that was not 7 and not 7:30. What was there something? Was there something like I need 7:15? Is there something emotional about that?
You know what? I start on a quarter hour. No, that was just what they offered me, and it's better than 11 p.m. So,
Okay, well, that's true. Yeah, because it's one show only, so people don't
exactly.
want to miss this.
Right.
How do you, because if we watch you in American Horror Story, which it's not a, I mean, you could argue that there's some smiles in it just because of the nature of how the show's going, but and even Somebody Somewhere, while it's also a soft comedy. I mean, it's, but how do you identify? Because I guess you identify as a the comic, the stand-up comedian, but at the same time, there's just so much more to you. What's your identity?
That's interesting. I think I identify. First and foremost, I do identify as a comedian. That's where I got my start. That's really what got me into the biz, showbiz. I was an improviser for many, many, many years at the Upright Citizens Brigade. And most of my, if you look on my IMDb, it's just me playing waiters on sitcoms. I'm always my niche is a bitchy customer service representative, I'm always the
Right.
one.
That's a start.
Exactly.
When I first saw you, you reminded me of somebody. And then when I did sort of study your bio, you actually have been on a show with this person in repeated ways. So that's your hint. Is there anybody? I mean, do you have any idea of who I'm going to say?
Are you going to say Jack McBrayer?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a poor man's Jack McBrayer.
Well, I don't know. So I did say that. Had you heard that before? Do you agree? Do you think there's kind of a McBrayerus about you?
I think so. I think we're both sort of corn fed, and I actually auditioned for the role of Kenneth before the
Ah.
pilot of 30 Rock, and it was very clear that the role was written for Jack. And I knew Jack from the UCB theater and the improv world, and but I did get to like meet Tina Fey because I auditioned for it and things like that,
Alec Baldwin.
Yeah, well, I didn't meet Alec Baldwin
Oh.
until later, but yes, he wasn't in the auditions. But then I did actually. She tossed me a couple roles on the show as a
Yeah,
kindness.
which is great. I know. I think you describe your career as sort of a 20-year overnight success.
Exactly. I moved here in 2001, and just 22 short years later, I am the star of an HBO show.
Well, you're in New York though, right? That's home.
Yes.
So, and that makes sense. But at the same time, why not LA? I mean, you could do Chicago. There was a lot of stuff here and you film here, but did you think of, am I New York or am I Chicago? I mean, New York is about getting more on stage, I think.
Right. And I do love being in the theater. I think your audience might understand and appreciate that as well. Yeah, I do. I've done a lot of off-Broadway theater and things like that. But I did live in LA for 4 years. And that saying, if you can make it here, you can make it anywhere, about
Yep.
New York. It's not true, because I tried to make it in LA and I didn't. I've had a lot more
Ah.
success in New York City. I think I guess I'm more a flavor for the East Coasters than the West Coast.
Well, that would suggest to me it's because your humor is more biting, your humor. So tell us a bit about what we're going to get in the stand-up show, because obviously in Somebody Somewhere and all the things you do what you're told to do,
Right.
the roles and characters you have to play.
Right.
But and I plan to be there and see you on February 4th.
Oh.
What am I in for? I have not seen you do stand-up. What am I in for?
Well, I'm not, it's not like a Bob Saget situation where I'm all of a sudden just like filthy I'm talking about sex and
There's
whatever.
still a chance, but
Exactly. Maybe. I don't know.
if
We'll see. We'll see what
I'm in the
happens
audience,
before
there may be a
February.
chance.
Exactly. But it's this is a story about or it's not a story, it's stand up, but my stand up is about being a little awkward, being a little a bit of a square peg, trying to fit into round holes.
It
And
sounds like it might be Jeff Hiller.
it's very Jeff Hiller.
Well, isn't that,
It's
I
very
mean,
Joel. It's very Joel, actually. I have
okay,
very
very
much a
Joel. That
Joel feel.
works too. Your character on Somebody Somewhere. I'm not a stand-up comic. I don't do that, but everything I've always learned about it is what makes a stand-up comic effective is you can't get up there and be Bob Saget. You have to start with material that is the life of Jeff Hiller. So are we getting a
Completely.
lot that is you, or is it sort of well embellished, got to play with it?
Oh no, I don't do that. I don't need to do that. My life is that humiliating.
Humiliating enough. I don't have to make anything up.
Exactly. No, I don't really make anything up. I mean, it is sort of based in storytelling. I do use a lot of like what happened in my life. It's not observational. It's not like Seinfeld where it's like, you ever notice? It's not that. It's storytelling and telling you about my life and things that happened to me, things like
You know,
that.
I'm soon. I don't know if you know Alex Edelman. I'll be interviewing
I
him
do. I
in
know
another
Alex
day, and
well.
he made me and so he made me think of you as well because stand up. But at the same time, Alex's approach. Well, we're both Jewish. It probably comes from that. But Alex's approach. Well, he was on Broadway, right? He took his show to Broadway, and that
Yeah.
made me wonder, why does one stand up say I belong in clubs and on those stages? Although the Den arguably is. Goes either way, actually, to be honest with you. I don't know if you've been there before, but it goes either way in terms of how you look at it. And Broadway is Broadway. What is it that makes a stand-up say, no, I belong on that kind of performing stage and not necessarily a club?
Right. Well, I mean, Alex has done a lot of club work too, I think, but I think that both of us, we what they used to call we're alt comics, meaning like we talk a lot about our lives, and it's more storytelling based rather than just joke, 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 joke. It's more here's an arc. I'm going to tell you this. Like, for instance, that show that Alex did on Broadway is about this one experience that he had, and my show is about it's about like my search for meaning. So there's like this whole sort of overarching arc to mine, and that's why I'm more. Yeah, Joe's Pub, the Den. I'm more of a familiar, arty kind of mood than like a, oh boy, dogs be like this, but cats be like that, right?
Right. Well, stay with the dogs. By the way, since you are that Joe's Pub kind of guy, coming up, it's already the interview's done. We haven't posted it yet, but I interviewed Gail Papp, Joe Papp's widow,
Oh, wow.
about that whole life. So Joe's Pub makes me think of that, and of course, that whole world. Do you have a preference? I mean, is the TV thing, the stand-up, the drama TV, or when somebody comes to you and says, you know, we want you to be in the next Four Things, you know, part two. I don't know if you've seen that movie yet.
I
You
have
just have
not,
to
but I
move
really want to
carefully.
see it.
Oh my
I've
God,
seen
it's
a lot of it.
unbelievable.
It looks amazing, and I hear she's amazing.
Well, can I tell you, for the first like maybe 10 minutes, you're going to say, I probably shouldn't have bought my popcorn because I don't know if I'm going to make it. And then you kind of, I'm not saying you, I mean, it's just, but then you get it. And
Yeah.
once you kind of get it, I didn't want it to end.
Oh, wow.
So cool, so weird. Deserve more Golden Globes than it got. But anyway, back to you. What I just
Right.
randomly picked that
Well,
title.
I mean, listen, if Yorgos Lanthimos wants to work with me, yes, please. Okay. I'll do anything. Paul, I'll do anything. I will do a web series for $25 where I pay them the $25. I love doing everything. The nice thing that what I've really, really grown to love is being on a TV series. Like I love doing the theater, but there is something that becomes tiring when you do it 8 times a week. You start to lose the freshness. And the great thing about a TV series is it's you get to play this character, so you really know this character, but you get to do all these different adventures. And also you get to know the crew and your other actors, and you become this community. And so it's just so much easier to perform in that sense versus I'm here for 2 days. My name is Jeff. My name is Jeff. I'm not number 204 on the call sheet. My name is Jeff.
Right.
It feels so that part I really, really enjoy versus all those years of being a guest star and.
Yeah, the other day we had one of the cast members of Hamilton,
Oh, wow.
cooking on our midday news
Yeah.
and making empanadas. He was and I said to him, "Do you have a restaurant?" He goes, "No, I'm just cooking."
I
And of course,
love
I've
it.
seen Hamilton in, what?
I love that this like singer, dancer, actor is also a really good chef, so much so that they like put him on the television.
Yeah, well, I think part of that has to do with we're all Hamilton fans, so that might be it. Because
Fair.
making Pop-Tarts was not that tough. No, he made empanadas, and but the thing is, I so I said to him, I said, now look, I've seen Hamilton a gazillion times. What, you know, who I was embarrassed to say, but who are you? He goes, oh, I'm man number five, and that makes me think of what you're saying. So can't we call you Bob?
Oh, I have been. I'm usually gay man number five, but I have definitely had that little role. Yeah, I remember the first time I got a character who had a name, and it was like, oh my God, is he gonna have something more to do?
I love, what do I have to be somebody? Joel, who, by the way, you must run into people on the street who call you Joel.
Sometimes,
I would think. Well, better than your the murdering character. Oh my God,
People
there he is.
recognize me from that too. It's shocking how many people are like, oh, you kill people, right? And I'm really thrilled about it.
There might even be a bigger audience for that, to be honest. I don't know. I mean, I think somebody somewhere probably has a niche kind of audience. I tripped over it and then fell in love with it.
Yeah, it's not a lot of people watch it, but the people who do love it.
Yeah.
Love it, love it.
And so when we were on radio, I brought up a topic that's sad, and I brought it up at the end of the interview. And so it was horrible of me because we ended up crying with each other and I went to commercial break. So but I can't do that again, but I do want to bring it up because people who are fans of the show and people in Chicago, and I think a lot of the audience that watches this, I mean, it's on the internet, it's everywhere, but certainly Chicago. One of the stars of that show is Mike Haggerty, and he unexpectedly passed away. He played Bridget's father in the show. And so he died, I think, just before season two started.
2 weeks, 2 weeks before we started shooting.
Which means he's in the scripts, all that kind of stuff. And now there's creative decisions that have to be made. And not that you made those creative decisions, but can you fill people in? Because I'll be honest, I waited for that episode and I thought maybe he died and they had already put a few in the can. I waited for that episode when they addressed it and they never did.
Right. They wanted, we loved him. We loved him. I mean,
And well known in Chicago, very familiar
I
face in
mean, yeah,
Chicago.
Second City. And basically, if you wanted a Chicago type, you would have hired Mike
Yeah.
Haggerty. mustache and start talking like this. and he was the best. You always wanted to be on set with him. He would say really hilarious things under his breath, like at table reads and stuff. And like I remember when we got picked up for season two, he was like, oh, I've never heard those words together before. Season two, season two. It was so funny. And I think, the first season of our show was all about grief. It was all about Bridget's character grieving the fact that her sister had died. And so I think tonally and storytelling wise, they didn't want to have a story about grief for the second season as well. And he was such a beloved character. I think that just like
Because they
story.
might need to kill somebody off every season too at that point, if that's what the show's going to be about.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. And as an actor on the show, I don't pr approve of that decision.
Right. Who's expendable? No, but it was a loss because he was also a very fun character and added
He
so
was
much
lost.
charm to it.
Yes. I mean, such a good actor too, and such a wonderful human being. And so I think another big reason, this is what the producer told me, she was just like, I just don't want to say goodbye to him yet. And I was like, well, I can't argue with that. That's
But maybe season three they do address it, or you don't know yet.
I don't know yet, but I have no idea actually. But I'm not in the writer's room, but
Okay.
I do what they tell me.
And your character Joel gets a boyfriend as the show goes on. I think it
Yes.
stays stable towards the end. I guess we'll see where that goes. But I'm always curious about that because, the whole issue and debate within the community, because I'm a good friend with Alexandra Billings, if you know her, and who
Yeah.
played Madame Horrible and Wicked and all that kind of stuff. And so this whole notion of, do you cast gay people and gay characters? Is it wrong to cast a straight person and a gay character? Well, you can't have a straight person playing gay. You can't have a gay person playing straight. All this kind of stuff. So, you are openly gay. You're married. You got a husband and a dog, most importantly. And so you play a character, but is that important to you? Like, if you were hired and they said, no, we need you to be totally, we need you to be Mike Brady, which is an interesting name to pick when you think about it, but
Yeah,
we need
seriously.
you to be Mike Brady, have six kids. Are you like, hey, I'm an actor, I don't care? Or is it about, no, I got to be true to myself and all that?
Well, I think that what it really comes down to, especially with trans actors, where it's like you would never, I think it's maybe there's probably one exception that proves the rule, but it's so. I know that Patty Harrison actually played a cisgendered woman, but it's so rare that a queer person would be cast as in a straight role. So if that happened, I'd be like, oh, okay. But when the very few trans roles come up, or and now with gay men,
it is different today.
Yeah, it's more common that there'll be a gay role in shows. But if you cast a straight actor in that, that straight actor is also being cast in lots of straight roles, whereas I mean, I would play Mike Brady, but no one has asked me to. So
Alice, I can see it then.
That's more likely, actually. Oh, the soup's on. But I think that that's where the political side of it comes into effect. And so when a trans role comes up specifically and you cast a cisgendered straight actor who pretends to be trans, then that one role that was available is taken. And I can see why that becomes an issue.
I like to think people are enlightened today, and they are more enlightened today, but a friend of mine is starring in Company, and he plays one of the gay married couple. And he just posted something, which was Instagram, whatever kind of post it was, from somebody who in a smaller town somewhere, but who basically said, I went to see Company and I had no idea they made these changes. Apparently she wasn't bothered by Bobby becoming a woman, but was bothered by the fact that there's now a gay couple in it and left it intermission. And, you know, I want my money back and this is just the wrong thing. And of course his comment to that was, well, I'm proud and I live my life and all of that. I like to think we're beyond those days, but I guess we're not.
Well, you know, I mean, it's a real bizarrely hot topic issue that I thought we were beyond too, and it really felt like we had some real footing. And I feel especially bad for queer kids, where it was like, oh boy, you are so lucky to be born now, and now because of these culture wars, they're the young people who are suffering the most. And
yeah,
I do feel bad for them.
So is your show, we'll take it back to that. I want to keep popping back to the den in our discussion. Do you bring politics in it? I mean, is it sort of like, no, it's just, it's, I don't know, how is the show about 90 minutes or 60 minutes or?
75.
Okay. Hence the 7:15.
Maybe that's what it was.
We need them to end on the hour.
Yeah, it's like something about the freeway or something.
Yeah. No, not where you're going.
Oh, no.
No. You're on a street where I'm trying to find parking now for when you're here on February 4th at 7:15.
Oh, no, I'm so sorry. I'm actually, we just got into our garage here in our building and we are buying a car tomorrow. And it's very exciting. I'm thinking about parking and everything.
Yeah, New York. It's what have you done? Oh, you didn't have a car.
I didn't have a car. Yeah. I had a car for 22 years. But now I'm a previously owned car owner.
Yeah, got a place to put it, so
that's right, exactly. I gotta get a car.
I won't even ask what the rent for that space is, but it probably knows people's mortgage.
I know. Well, it's a deal for New York City, but I wouldn't call it a deal overall. What was your question about am I political
in the show?
Yeah, I guess I'm not apolitical, but it's not all about politics. I mean, I think because I am a queer person, and because I live in the world, sometimes, you know, the personal is political. But I definitely am not going at it being like, you know, my Daily Show audition. This is it's more about personal stories about me.
So I guess what I'm saying, for people who may be watching this and, oh, do I want to go see Jeff, whatever, are they seeing Joel? Are they seeing me? Who are they seeing? I know they're seeing Jeff, I know, but yeah. Who are they seeing on stage? Is it somebody they've seen before?
You mean like, who's my type? Who's my comedy type?
Who's your character? Like? Oh, sure. You know what? That would inform. So if there's somebody that you pattern yourself after.
I'm just realizing I'm not like many people. All I can say is it's very much me. It's very much in the same way that I'm just talking with you now. It's me talking with the audience, and it's very much about.
This is not a performance.
Yeah. It is. Well, are you denying that we've fully scripted this entire conversation?
I'm not denying.
I am still reading the transcript right now. I think it's about. I mean, one of the jokes in it is called, I say, I Welcome to my show about Jeff's search for meaning. And I know that the saying is actually man's search for meaning, but come on. And it's really about, it's about growing up in the church and how I was super into the church and how I...
That's Joel.
That is Joel. And I became a social worker after college, and I talk about that. And I also have three stories about human anatomical buttholes. So I guess I should...
Part of the social work, at what point is it?
It is actually one of them is. I guess I should warn you that there's a lot of butthole content, and none of it leads to sex, which is both surprising and humiliating. But
so family friendly to some degree.
I think it's yeah. I mean, I maybe wouldn't bring your 4-year-old. But, I mean, I think they'd be bored.
Teenagers fine.
Yeah, I think a teenager is fine. I mean, you know, there's some cursing, but it's not. There's no explicit. Sexual content or anything.
And do you, I mean, you've been doing the stand-up for a long time. Who does come to you? So I'm trying to get the word to Chicago here, but who is generally in your audience? Are you looking at the middle-aged folks? Well, I pointed myself, yes. But, you know, are you saying, oh, no, I get a young crowd. Who's coming to see you?
I am very big amongst my peers of the middle-aged persuasion. And, I also have a lot of folks who have been following me in New York for a while because I am sort of a downtown comedian who has a name. I'm doing air quotes because it's, you know, the yeah. name is small because the world is small. But so I have a lot of people who like, you know, slightly acidic comedy with a lot of heart. It's a lot of heart, but it's also, you know, we're not afraid to take the little piss out of each other.
Right. You know, get ready for what will happen to you in some years.
Oh, yeah.
When I do public appearances and that kind of stuff, where I'm signing things, I'll just never forget this. This young guy comes up and I went, oh, how cool. You know, he walks in, he goes, oh yeah, you're the guy on the news. Yeah. He goes, my grandmother loves you. I said, I'm signing nothing for you.
I've already gotten that, Paul. A lot of like, oh, my mom watches your show.
Yeah, right. it goes right up. It's kind of like, then why do you know about it? You're lying, you know?
Exactly.
But yeah, right there is so much of the, or would you sign this? My mom, I want to bring this home for, you know, no, not for you.
Right, exactly. I just happened to walk in the room once and that's how I recognize you.
Okay.
All right.
Well, you know, you live in New York, you're on the street, you know, I mean, for example, like Matt Friend, who's from here, and he posts all these videos, you know, Matt, right, the impressionist, and he's always got all these famous people, and he goes, you know, people think I've set these up. He goes, I run into these people. It's New York. They're around. Is that your life? Do you walk down the street and, oh, there's, you know, there's Robert De Niro.
Oh, well, I've never seen De Niro, but you do occasionally see a celebrity. Yeah, yeah, it's not. I wouldn't say that I have tons of videos of me and my celebrity, but I'm one of those people who's like, Ben Affleck, it's Ben Affleck.
And I love when celebs are nice. You know, I don't usually bother them when I see it, but I can be a geek about that. So, I mean, I'm more of the take me backstage type.
Right,
So I, during Hello Dolly, David Hyde Pierce brought me backstage and, you know, that's sort of nice. Hi, Gavin Crimp. But anyway, But one time, and this was, and I can say this now because he's gone, but the one time I said, I need to say hello, it was Neil Simon. And he was sitting and having dinner, and how do you just not, and I just went up and I just said, I just want to say thank you for the work. I don't mean to bother, but I mean, you're Neil Simon.
Right. You know?
And I'm not going to say he wasn't nice, but I'm going to say
it
didn't follow up with selfie. No, we're not. It followed up with go back to your bread.
That's interesting. I will say I met Marsha Mason and I said, oh,
I get
love
the tie.
Your work. Exactly. I said, I just love your work. And she was like, oh, thanks, honey. And we had a lovely, I mean, we were also, you know, both acting and in a festival, so it wasn't quite the same thing, but she was incredibly warm. And
you know what? There's nothing better than when, and maybe when we're off camera one day, we'll talk about those people who do not meet the definition of being warm, because they happen. And I've got a story that you will love, not to be told now. And it's a name you know.
Oh, I cannot wait.
But I do remember, like, I was walking down the street once and I saw Reed Carney, and I love Reed Carney. And Getting out of Hades Town and stuff. So I said, oh, can we take a picture together? And he says, yeah, let's, put my girlfriend in the picture with us. And I was thinking she would take the picture. So it didn't work that way. But anyway.
Was she in the center or could you crop?
Did you? No, she was on the end. It was probable. Yeah, so just remove these people out. Talk about what is coming up for you. You've got the Den Theater, but it's a one-shot only thing. Are we part of a tour? What's bringing you to Chicago for that? Are you back here to start filming?
I'm back there to start shooting season 3. And so I thought, well, why not throw in a show right before we start shooting? And
Have we seen you on Chicago stage before?
no, I've never been in,
I
I've
didn't think so. That's yeah.
done anything in the stage. No, I would love to be. I mean, I guess I'm making my debut at the Den on February 4th at 7:15.
They better be making. I'm going to make a big deal about that. This is your Chicago debut, and by the way, you're going to love. I don't know if you. I'm sure you've been in show that is even audiences here in Chicago, but Chicago
Yes.
audiences are the best. Ask Jerry Mitchell. I mean, they're everybody drives their shows out here before Broadway because
They really
these are
do,
the
don't
audiences they
they?
want to talk about. Talk to.
And it's also, it's a big, fun, fancy city. And I've been to the second city 1,000 times.
I'm there all the time. Yeah.
Love it. Love it.
Yeah.
Love
Oh, I think I told you when I had you on radio. I think it was just before you. I have cast of Second City
it.
all in studio. Great fun. And now you're not Second City trained, though.
No, I'm UCB trained, but UCB was born out of people who found each other at the Second City. So I don't know, it's kind of vestigial.
Is there a kind of like when you see whether you're running into a Steve Carell or whatever names you want to run into, but is there sort of a, I did this group, you were Second City? Is that a connecting thing for you or not really?
Yeah, I think there is a little respect there. Yeah, and I think that anybody who starts out in improv is has that respect and has that yeah, I see you. We're the same kind of idea because it is a very specific type of training, and
Yeah.
it's he very helpful, very
Yeah.
helpful.
Yeah, my partner's going through the training now. And so at dinner the
Oh.
other night, we had to do a thing with, I'll hold a spoon up, but let's pretend it's not a spoon. I'm like, I'm not in that class. It's a spoon. Well, anyway.
Classic improv
Exactly. Well, I'm trying to give you some material for the show coming up,
move. Oh, I like it. Thank you.
But you're going to be at the Den Theater on Milwaukee. It's actually 1331 North Milwaukee. You're in Chicago's Wicker Park neighborhood. I don't know where you're staying, but that's like a cool neighborhood to be in.
I'm staying in Naperville. I don't know if that's so cool.
Oh, well, they have a rib fest every year, and the mayor who's gone now used to be officer friendly. There's plenty of Naperville things to do.
Perfect.
But I think we'll see you in the city. And
Perfect.
it's February 4th, Sunday, February 4th, and it's at 7:15 p.m. You're on the main stage, the Heat main stage, and tickets are at the Den Theater, spelled the proper British way, TRE. Love that.
Gotcha.
DenTheater.com. I hope it's
Classic.
selling really great. I'm going to do some checking because I'm telling everybody I know to go check it out.
Oh,
And I just,
thank
I don't
you.
know. There was something about you when I first saw you. I said, this guy is great. And then there you are coming here. And I immediately reached out to the agent and said, can I please talk to him? So
Thank
thank
you. I
you.
appreciate it.
So thank you, and I'll see you on February 4th and break a leg here in Chicago.
Thank you, Paul. I appreciate
Thanks, Jeff.
it.